A new COVID strain known as JN.1, now deemed a variant of interest by the World Health Organization. The variant has been spreading rapidly throughout multiple parts of the world, but the WHO says it poses a low global health risk. Current COVID-19 vaccines also continue to provide adequate protection against the strain. The WHO advises the public to mask up in closed areas and to stay home if they are experiencing COVID symptoms. And let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Hi, Chanel.
Good morning, Bettina. Good morning to everyone. There's a low pressure area outside our far. Anyway, due to this trough, expect a cloudy sky with scattered rain showers over Calayan Island. However, the shear line will continue to affect Cagayan, Isabela, Aurora, Quezon, so expect also a cloudy sky with scattered rain showers and thunderstorm. Northeast monsoon continues to affect northern Luzon, so expect a cloudy sky with rain here in Cordillera Administrative Region, Cagayan Valley, Ilocos Norte, and Ilocos Sur. For the rest of Ilocos Region, expect a partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated light rains. Here in Metro Manila and the rest of our country, easterlies will prevail and expect a partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated rain showers and thunderstorms. And that's the latest here in PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Chanel Dominguez and good morning.
Thank you very much for that, Chanel. The provinces of Cavite and Nueva Ecija already experiencing drought ahead of the expected peak of El Nino, Rafael Busano reports.
The Philippines is beginning to feel the effects of El Nino, with the provinces of Nueva Ecija and Central Luzon and Cavite and Southern Luzon already experiencing drought, according to the State Weather Bureau. At least 25 areas in different parts of the country are also dealing with a dry spell, while five others are grappling with dry conditions. An area is considered to be experiencing dry condition if it receives below normal rainfall for two consecutive months. A dry spell, on the other hand, is described as below or way below normal rainfall conditions for a longer period. The worst condition is drought, characterized by five consecutive months of below normal or 3 months of way below normal rainfall. PAGASA warns the number of areas affected by the El Nino through dry conditions, dry spells, and droughts will likely increase, the most of which is forecast in April.
Majority of global climate models suggest that El Nino will likely persist until March-April-May 2024. While stronger El Nino events increases the likelihood of El Nino-related climate anomalies, it does not necessarily equate to strong impacts or emerge in all locations.
This means that while rainfall may be below normal in most parts of the country, some areas, particularly Mindanao, will still get showers. Below normal rainfall will first be felt by the western section of Luzon in the first month of 2024. This will stretch to almost all of Luzon and a big portion of Visayas by February. Normal rains are forecast to return to majority of the Philippines by May and June, the period of transition to La Niña. The greatest impact of El Niño is on the water supply, which is needed for agriculture and everyday living. The public is also encouraged to conserve water and immediately repair or report leaking water lines. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine government's 2024 budget signed into law by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. The bulk of the spending plan is allocated to education and infrastructure. Katrina Domingo tells us more.
The Philippine government will see a 500 billion peso increase in its national budget in 2024. That's after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. signed the 5.76 trillion peso spending measure, which is 9.6% higher than this year's national budget. The chief executive says the minimal increase is deliberate, as his administration is trying to reduce the government's borrowings.
Like any government, we are curtailed by what we can collect, by what our tax coffers contain. We can be reckless, take the easy path, borrow, let our children pick today's tab up tomorrow. But debt is not the kind of inheritance that we want to leave those who will come after us.
Budget Secretary Amina Pangandaman says the Philippines' debt under the 2024 General Appropriations Act shrunk to 5% from this year's 6.1%. The Marcos Jr. administration hopes to further pull down this number to 3% before the president steps down in 2028. While the palace has yet to release a full copy of the 2024 GAA, the budget secretary says among the sectors that will receive big chunks of the budget include the education, infrastructure, and social amelioration sectors. She adds the president did not directly veto line items under the 2024 budget.
Walang direct veto. Most of it are conditional and general observations. Ang general observations po, parang may mga comments lang on how to implement the budget. Ang conditional implementation ng subject to implementing rules and regulations or guidelines to be issued by respective departments. So yun, kiniklear lang po namin yun doon sa veto message.
But former Senator Franklin Drilon says he agrees with Minority Leader Coco Pimentel's recommendation for the president to veto the unprogrammed funds.
Kaya ako sang-ayo na dapat i-veto yan. Hindi po sa dahilan na nabag sa saligang batas, kung hindi sa dahilan na ginamit itong paraan na ito para lakihan ang pork barrel. Ulitin ko lang pareho ang maliwanag sa ating mga kababayan. Ang unprogrammed funds ay pwede at unprogrammed projects ay pwede mo lang gamitin kung ang revenues, ang taxes natin na nakukolekta
ay lampas,
ay mahigit doon sa program ng pamahalaan. Halimbawa lang, kung ang program na revenue na taxes ay 1 billion, pag lumagpas ng 1 billion, sabihin natin ng 1.1 billion, ang 0.1 billion pwede mong gamitin sa unprogram funds or program project.
Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri says the budget of the defense sector was hiked by 10 billion pesos as the Philippines plans to procure three large ships for the Philippine Coast Guard next year. Meantime, the president reminds government officials to spend the 2024 fund judiciously to ensure that the public will enjoy the full rebate of their taxes.
Implementation delay and illegal deviations inflict the same havoc of denying the people of the progress and development that they deserve. So with this reminder comes the most important budget commandment that we must always heed. We are working for the people, not for ourselves. We are working for the country, not for ourselves.
So far, the government has yet to fully consume its 5.2 trillion budget for 2023. Pangandaman says, while the government has released 98% of the fund, only 80% has been utilized. But the budget chief adds that this should not be a problem as the 2023 budget has a two-year validity and will expire in 2024. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
The board of the Maharlika Investment Corporation takes shape as President Marcos swears in four new directors: Vicky Castillo Tan, Andrew Jerome Gan, Herman Lichauco, and Roman Felipe Reyes took their oaths Wednesday. Tan, a longtime ADB executive, worked at various financial institutions, including Citibank, while Gan held various director roles with the likes of Globe Land Development Corporation. Meanwhile, Lichauco has served as a director for Sharp Philippines, and Reyes is currently a director at Converge ICT Solutions. Four slots of the board that will manage the country's first sovereign wealth fund are already filled by ex-officio members. These are MIC President Rafael Consing Jr., Finance Chief Benjamin Jokno, Budget Chief Amina Pangandaman, and NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan. The Philippine Central Bank keeps its hawkish tone at least until the early part of next year. BSP Governor Eli Remolona says interest rates may stay higher for longer as inflation remains above government's target range of 2 to 4%. And even if inflation settles within that range, Remolona says they would still consider other factors before cutting rates. The BSP has hiked its benchmark rate to a 16-year high of 6.5% in a bid to tame inflation.
If most of the numbers point in the right direction, including expectations, they really settle into this comfortable range around 3% for inflation, then we will consider cutting rates.
Turning now to tensions in the West Philippine Sea, Manila hits back at Beijing for its accusations the Philippines should be blamed for the growing maritime row in the region. Defense Chief Gilberto Teodoro says, unlike the Philippines, no country has backed Beijing's claims over the whole South China Sea. Aside from Manila, Vietnam, Malaysia, and Brunei have overlapping claims with China in the disputed waters.
No country in the world, none, supports unequivocally their claim to the whole of the South China Sea. Now, on the Philippine side, a lot of countries support our sovereignty and jurisdiction and sovereign rights over the exclusive economic zone and other areas where we have territorial jurisdiction. And no country in the world, none, to this time, has condemned the Philippines in what it's doing.
Amid the rising tensions, the Philippine government is ramping up efforts to modernize its armed forces. It received an air surveillance radar system from Japan Wednesday, which can help the country detect approaching fighter jets and missiles.
We are not going to disclose the areas that we are going to put up future radars, but this is a strategic location, as you saw in the audiovisual, even since before. Because this is an exit point of our international airspace and our an entry point to Philippine airspace, and it is naturally open to the West Philippine Sea, and it is unobstructed, so it affords us and us in the past. The U.S. in the past, unobstructed vision.
A festive air is felt in the Diliman campus of the University of the Philippines as it holds its annual lantern parade. In keeping with tradition, the lanterns symbolize the advocacies of the UP community. Jose Carretero tells us more.
Christmas lanterns of different sizes and colors were showcased at the University of the Philippines Diliman campus in the annual UP Lantern Parade. UP students once again show their wit, creativity, and message in their lantern creations. The UP College of Architecture featured Filipinos' family ties in their lantern display using recyclable materials. The National College of Public Administration and Governance drew inspiration from Atlas as their lantern symbolizes the strength of Filipinos despite the challenges. The traditional lantern parade is also an opportunity for the community to express their stand on current issues. For the College of Social Sciences and Philosophy, they rolled out a vinta which symbolizes Filipinos' will to push through despite rough waters. They also expressed their opposition to the jeepney phase-out.
Hindi naman po total yung mga drivers sa modernization. Mas nagkakol lang po talaga ng just the transition, pati po ng makamasang oriented ng public transportation.
The UP College of Mass Communication used newspapers, CD, and bottles in their message to strengthen the new media landscape. They also call for the responsible use of artificial intelligence.
Bitbit po talaga namin yung mga panawagang yes to responsible AI, defend academic freedom, and no to UP budget cuts.
The UP Press highlighted books and a star, which they say is a symbol of light, especially on social issues. This year's theme is Panibagong Lakas or New Strength.
Ibig sabihin, yun nga, nagbabalik mula sa pandemic, no? Hindi lang lakas per se, pero pinapasok doon yung alternative energy, pinapasok doon yung renewed commitment at saka dedication pagdating sa tinatawag na academic excellence, sa honor and integrity sa public service.
A special competition was held for entries from the College of Fine Arts because their lanterns won many times in previous years. Many spectators were delighted with the creativity of the participants. More than 70 groups participated in the academic unit category. The winning lantern design will receive 50,000 cash. Jose Carretero, EBS-CBN News.